Welcome to Woodhill Evangelical Church under somewhat different circumstances than we had originally anticipated, but it's good to be with you as we continue this journey through Holy Week. We've been studying as a church recently in the Gospel according to Mark, and as I was studying recently in Mark chapter 14, some of the people that we meet there become very significant in the narrative as we continue through Holy Week. As we come to the beginning of Mark chapter 14, we read how the preparations for Passover are now in full sway, and there's a real sense of urgency amongst the religious leaders of the day that they really want to be done with Jesus and with everything that surrounds Jesus. Mark specifically states that they want to arrest him and to kill him, and in order to do that, they needed the collusion and the cooperation of the Roman authorities. So as we continue this inevitable journey to the cross during this Holy Week, I want to take time to consider the responses to Jesus of three different people whom we meet in Mark chapter 14 as these monumental events unfold. There Mary, who was the sister of Martha and Lazarus. Then there is Judas Iscariot, and then the disciple Peter. First of all, let's consider Mary, the sister of Martha and Lazarus, who reside in Bethany. Mary anoints Jesus with a very expensive perfume. Mary's motive is to worship and to honour the Lord. Jesus goes further and tells us that she poured perfume on my body beforehand to prepare for my burial. It was an expensive sacrifice for Mary to make. The price involved was a common worker's annual income. But there is such a deep significance in her act of worship for the Lord. But there are others looking on who could not see this. Their eyes are spiritually blinded to the truth. All they can see is the expense that has been involved in this act. They try to disguise their motives as a concern for the poor, but Jesus knows what really lies within their hearts. And today, well, today we still remember, as the Lord said, Mary's sacrificial worship for the Lord. In Mary, we see someone who worshipped and adored the Lord Jesus Christ. We then move on to think about our second character, Judas Iscariot. From John's account in chapter 12, we learn specifically that Judas was there leading the criticism of Mary for this outpouring of very expensive perfume under the guise that he was concerned about the poor. Judas was the treasurer among the disciples, and it's clear that his motives and priorities are not aligned to those of the Lord's. So while Jesus utters, "Your will be done," to his heavenly Father in the Garden of the Gethsemane, Judas is plotting his betrayal of Jesus. Was Judas disillusioned that Jesus did not come to be the political or military Messiah that he, along with others, hoped he would be? That he would be the one who would be ready to overthrow the occupying Roman authorities? We find that money as well as power was a motivating factor for Judas. And for 30 miserable pieces of silver, he would betray the Lord. The tragedy in the life of Judas is that by the time he realizes the horror, the true horror of the crime that he had committed, it's too late. And he finds it impossible to live with the consequences of his actions. So while in Mary we see a picture of one who worshipped and adored the Lord and worshipped him sacrificially as she anointed him for his burial, we see in Judas one who betrayed the Lord. And there is a solemn lesson for us from the life and the tragic death of Judas. We are all ultimately accountable to God for our actions and for the choices that we make in life. But let's move on to think about the third character. And the third character I want to briefly consider is another disciple. This time it's Peter. Yes, Peter, the impetuous spokesman, the one who was prepared to step out of the boat, and it has to be said, he stepped out of the boat while others would know it. And he's the one who declares in Mark chapter 14 and in verse 29, "Even if all fall away, I will know it." But the Lord himself warns Peter, and it's recorded in Luke chapter 22, "I tell you, Peter, before the rooster crows today, you will deny three times that you know me." Peter's three times denial of the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, Peter's human frailties, his weaknesses and his fear are demonstrated in the way that he denies the Lord, just as Jesus is taken away to be arrested and ultimately to be crucified. But Peter's story does not finish there, and we should be thankful for that fact. Because after the resurrection, Peter's life will be turned from defeat to victory. With three searching questions, we can read how the Lord lovingly restores Peter in John chapter 21. This same Peter, empowered by the Spirit of God on the day of Pentecost, as recorded for us in Acts chapter 2, becomes a powerful spokesman and indeed a foundational leader within the Christian church. So what made the difference in Peter's life? Why do we see this remarkable transition, this remarkable transformation in the life of a man who had failed? Well, for Peter's part, I think there is true repentance for the wrong that he had done. So he makes a total change of direction within his life, and he exercises true faith in the living God through his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Then I believe also that the Lord empowers Peter by his Spirit to live and serve as God had truly intended for Peter. So we do see a true transition from fear to faith. And what a lesson that is for us in these days of great uncertainty. We're well aware of all the circumstances around us, of COVID-19 and all the fear and uncertainty it brings with it. If we ever need a faith in our living God just now, it is surely at this time. And Peter presents to us an example of a man who made this transition from fear to faith. Yes, the man who had denied the Lord three times would go on to suffer persecution for his Lord, and he would eventually die a martyr's death. Why the change? Because Peter became a man who no longer tried to live in his own strength and in his own power, but he came to live by the strength and the enabling of God and the Spirit of God living within his life. So what about us? What about you and me? Through the example of Peter, we see that there is a path to restoration and to forgiveness in Christ. No matter what has happened for us in the past, we continue our Holy Week journey to the cross and then to the glorious event of the resurrection itself. And Peter shows us that there is such a path to restoration, to forgiveness, even when we have failed and perhaps failed in a big way in the past. So may it be as we continue on this journey that we, like our Lord, will resolve to say this week to the Heavenly Father, whatever happens, your will be done. It may be that we will have the desire to live lives like Peter, that are transformed by the power of God, that we seek to live in his strength by the power of his Spirit. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, as we make this journey through Holy Week, we are reminded of your love. We see in Mary a picture of such sacrificial love, which is also a reflection of the love demonstrated by the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross as he gave himself for us. Our Father, how we thank you that your Son was prepared to pay the price in order that we might be forgiven and know what it is to have eternal life and eternal peace and relationship with the living God. Our Father, we thank you for the message of the gospel, the good news, the message of death, of burial, but also of resurrection. And so today we come to worship a Saviour who has risen from the dead. Our Father, as we continue in this journey through Holy Week, we pray for our community. We realise the many challenges that we face these days, and we ask that you would be in control and that you would take control in the hearts and lives of men and women who are living in fear, that you would give us a confidence in yourself through your Son at this time. And so, our Father, we bring our worship to you and thank you for all that you do for us. In Jesus' name and for his glory, amen.
This is a call to the servant king. Thank you.